Okay, here we go. See? Now this is a museum in here. Just a second, I got the tickets. I'll give them to you in a minute.
That's fine. I'm excited.
Oh yeah, I did on Thursday. Well, hello. What's that? Well, do you agree?
Hi, Mike.
You guys are in a tree.
I know. Hey! Hey, that mess around me.
Northern forests were depleted, it became evident that the lumber barons had been short-sighted. Without a plan for selective culling and reseeding, the forests were gone. The lessons learned from the tragic devastation of these once abundant old-growth forests became the basis for modern, sustainable forestry practices. The sawmills are closed, and the lumber barons are gone. But the town they built is still here, as are some of their magnificent Victorian mansions, a reminder of the ambition and hard work of entrepreneurs, workers, and immigrants alike, and the classic American story of a town's boom and bust, and recovery. Welcome to the Sawmill Museum. Since rivers provided a way to transport the logs, sawmills sprang up all along the Mississippi River. and pounds grew up around them to support the growing population of loggers and mill workers. Much of the vast pine forests of the Great North Woods passed through Clinton sawmills and provided the lumber for building homes, businesses, and cities like Chicago and Kansas City. From the 1850s to the 1890s, there were close to 20 mills operating in Clinton and nearby towns like Hometown.
We had two generations of our family in the sawmill business. We moved to Hometown in 1933, so my father took over at that time. And at that time, there were about as many horse-drawn wagons as there were motorized vehicles. And it was always interesting to see them come up the road and most often turn into the mill. There, they unloaded their logs in back of the mill in the log piles. When the lumber went through the saws, it was quite a loud kind of a whining sound. And a good part of the time during the day, you would hear these sounds all over the town for quite a distance. It was so common that you didn't even think about it.
Logging was hard, sometimes dangerous work. Lumberjacks lived in primitive logging camps, moving often to wherever they could find work. Raftsmen were responsible for lashing the logs into huge rafts and steering them safely downriver to the mills. Mill workers worked long hours to keep up with the demand for lumber in boom towns around the country.
The first step when the log reaches the sawmill is to remove the bark and square up the log so that it can be cut into lumber. The process of cutting the log into lumber required a considerable amount of skill on the part of the operator. Different kinds of wood had to be handled differently. Working in a sawmill was a very dangerous occupation. The saw blades could break off or fly around the place. So if something broke, the operators had to know how to fix it or had to have someone nearby who could fix it. In the second half of the 19th century, the lumber industry in Clinton became dominant really for the whole country and created a number of multimillionaires in the process. As a consequence, then these lumber barons built some magnificent mansions here in the city of Clinton. Some of the important lumber families in town were the family of W.J. Young, the family of Chauncey Brown, the family of David Joyce, the Curtis family, and others. They became not only locally famous and connected, but for example, the Lambs and the Youngs were partners with Frederick Weyerhaeuser. In fact, in 1885, Chauncey Lamb's oldest son, Artemus, had a sit-down formal dinner party for 400 people, catered from St. Louis and Chicago for the wine, the food, the music, and the flowers. Which is probably the most elaborate party ever given in Clinton. In those days, the contrast between the life and privilege of the owners and the workers presented an enormous contrast. The workers who were only employed for part of the year because of the seasonal nature of the work, who earned very modest wages and lived in very humble houses.
New techniques were introduced to increase production. Steam power and powerful bandsaws could turn more logs into lumber and create a wider variety of board dimensions. The Clinton lumber industry peaked in 1892 with over 195 million board feet of lumber produced, enough to build about 25,000 houses, businesses, and barns.
In 1893, there was a serious recession, what was called a panic in those days, in the United States, which cut the demand for lumber. And at the same time, the forests in Wisconsin and Minnesota started to become depleted. And it was becoming increasingly apparent that the lumber industry in Clinton was about to come to an end.
As the northern forests were depleted, it became evident that the lumber mill...
What is this?
Hey, Zeb. What's happening?
I don't know.
You're on TV.
I'm going back in the giant tree.
Yeah?
Bye, Mike.
Okay.
Yeah.
Celebrate, celebrate. Oh, yeah. Come on now, everyone.
Who's coming up here?
Asa. Yeah. Hello.